Okay, friends. I suggest we start this session of the privacy platform for our regular participants. You know, this is the informal sandwich lunch that got slightly out of hand. very welcome, everybody. I'm pleased to see we have a very good turnout, and we also have a very good program for you today. But I'll start by saying that we have a couple of film crews here, notably one by Mrs. Laura Poitras. The name will probably sound familiar to most of you. So you know what the cameras are about, and I think your privacy and rights are probably in good hands with these people. So unless anybody has objections in principle, I suggest we start. So today we're going to talk about encryption versus surveillance, who's winning the cat and mouse game, because it's beginning to look more like a cat and mouse game. And recent reports have revealed that the NSA have access to encryption keys, and they paid tech companies to introduce backdoors in encryption protocols. So now we're going to talk about ways in which we can defend ourselves against governments spying on us, which is a very weird situation if you think of it. This is not something you'd ever thought possible in a modern, enlightened, liberal democracy, but unfortunately it has come to that completely innocent, bona fide people have to defend themselves against government snooping on them. Now, I'm shortly going to introduce the very interesting panel to you, but I'd just like to make a few general remarks and put this in a bit of context. We are currently discussing the so-called EU cybersecurity strategy, and there is a certain irony in that, because it's clearly designed by the European Commission, thinking about countries like China that might be spying on our citizens. But I think that at the time of drafting, the Commission officials didn't really think that it might actually be our closest friends and allies spying on our citizens, or indeed EU member state governments. Now, if we know this, you know, with the knowledge we have today, to paraphrase a Dutch expression, if we look at the cybercrime cybersecurity strategy of the European Commission, it looks slightly different. But I hope that the Commission will pursue cybersecurity as vigorously and protect us not only from, let's say, unfriendly governments that want to snoop on our citizens, but also from friendly governments and indeed our own governments. Now, I think we're going to learn a little bit more today about what we can and cannot do. But I think that we should always keep in mind that it is not for individual citizens to protect themselves against governments. Ultimately, it is the duty of public authorities to protect us from harm. We can be expected as individual citizens to behave responsibly and use common sense. But we cannot be expected to take the full responsibility of protecting ourselves from unlawful snooping and people trawling through our intimate data. So I'm very proud to present the panel to you. You all know the routines. We're going to have four short introductions of about 10 minutes each. After that, I'll open the floor for debate. You raise your hand, you state your name, and you'll have about 1 minute to put a question, not make a speech, but put a question. We aim to finish at about, let's say, 2:15, 2:20. We have a bit of margin, but this room really has to be empty by 2:30, so please keep that in mind. So, to my left, Mr. Ladar Levison, I hope I pronounced that correctly, who is the founder of the now ended encrypted email service Lavabit, used by Edward Snowden, as we all know. And last August, Mr. Levison closed his company, Lavabit, after pressure of US government officials who wanted full access to protected messages of his customers. And he chose to close down his company rather than betraying his promise of providing secure email services. And today we read in the news that, or I now understand that there is a download site where your customers can download their their email messages, so at least they have access again. And Mr. Levison is also, and understandably, raising funds to bring a case against the FBI before the US court. Then, to my right, left for the viewers, Mr. Jacob Appelbaum, certainly not his first visit to the European Parliament. We're very pleased to have you here. Mr. Appelbaum, as you know, is an encryption and security software developer and a research journalist, and he was also a panelist on the inquiry into the NSA snooping. And Mr. Appelbaum at the time also told us how he has been harassed and intimidated as a journalist by the government. Then to my right, Mr. Oerting, Mr. Troels Oerting, I think I got that right, who's the director of the Europol Cybercrime Center, otherwise known as EC3. Mr. Oerting has more than 30 years of experience in law enforcement, both in Danish and international police organizations, and you've been working with Europol since 2007, and since June last year, director of the then new Europol Cybercrime Center based in The Hague. And finally, to my far left, Mr. James Heather, computer security researcher at the University of Surrey, senior lecturer. And your field of research is mainly the application of formal methods to computer security problems, for example, analyzing security protocols and either finding attacks or proving that no attacks existed. So we're very curious to hear more about that. I'm going to invite the speakers in this same order, so I'm going to invite Mr. Levison to do his introduction first. You have the floor.
On? There we go. Thank you. For those of you who don't know who I am, I'll just start out by giving a little bit of background. My name is Ladar Levison, and I was the owner and still am the owner-operator of Lavabit, an email service that hopefully one day will be able to stand on its own without any references to Snowden. I thought it was great. There was a time right after the shutdown when my lawyer was talking to the press, and he didn't say the word Lavabit when asked who he was working for. He said Snowden's email provider, and I had to explain to him that you're not working for Snowden or Snowden's email provider, you're working for Lavabit. So hopefully one day I'll step out from that shadow and let the issue that I'm fighting for stand on its own, and that is the right to privacy. For those of you who don't know, it's actually only been in the news about a week now, because I've only been able to disclose it for about that long. Precisely what I'm fighting for in court is the right to protect a company's SSL keys. For those of you who don't know, SSL is the little lock icon in your browser that protects your e-commerce transactions. It's a core cryptographic technology or protocol that really protects communications on the internet and establishes trust in a person's identity. Quite simply, you encrypt something with somebody's public key and you know that only that company, or at least in theory, only that company can decrypt it. It guarantees that when you send your username and password, for example, to your bank, that only your bank can decrypt that information. And effectively what was going on is the FBI wanted to usurp my online identity, usurp my private key, and use it to masquerade as my business on the internet and intercept all of the communications coming in and out of my network. And of course, I wasn't comfortable with that, to say the least. More disturbing was the fact that I couldn't even tell anybody that it was going on. How do you have a debate? How do you discuss something publicly when nobody even knows that a particular law exists or that it's being applied in a certain way? So that's quite simply my fight. We filed our brief in the appeal last week, so now we sit back and we wait for a ruling and hope that, you know, it will be favorable. When I first started Lavabit 10 years ago, I thought the United States would be the perfect country for it. After all, we are, you know, the home of the brave and the land of the free. our Constitution is supposed to protect freedom at its most basic level. And as it turns out, I probably picked the worst, if not the second worst, country on the planet for hosting the service, China being the other one. But rather than pack up my bags and head to Europe, I decided that as an American, it would be important for me to stay and try and fight, to try and change the laws that I disagreed with. So, like I said, I'm sitting and waiting. If I win my battle in court, I'll reopen Lavabit and business will continue. And if I lose, I'll probably have to turn over my business to somebody in Europe who can run it for me, or in my place. And I'll go off and be a farmer or something like that. What we have here today is a debate on to what lengths a government and its law enforcement officers should be allowed to go when it comes to conducting investigations. It's the simple question of surveillance versus privacy. And a lot of people have accused me of being anti-government because I was anti-surveillance. And that's simply not true. I'm not anti-government. I'm simply pro-freedom. Think about that. I believe in the rule of law. I believe in the need to conduct investigations. But those investigations are supposed to be difficult for a reason. It's supposed to be difficult to invade somebody's privacy because of how intrusive it is, because of how disruptive it is. If we don't have our right to privacy, how do we have a free and open discussion? What good is the right to free speech if it's not protected, in the sense that you can't have a private discussion with somebody else about something you disagree with? Think about the chilling effect that that has. Think about the chilling effect it does have on countries that don't have a right to privacy. It's one thing for us to give up our rights, but what we're guaranteed is the ability to talk about the rights that we've lost in the hopes of regaining them. And if we can't have that discussion, we'll never be able to regain any of the freedoms that we may have given up. So that's why I take such an ardent view of how important it is to protect the right to privacy. And that's why I developed the service that I did. Quite simply, Lavabit was designed to remove the service provider from the equation. By not having logs on my server and not having access to a person's emails on disk, I wasn't eliminating the possibility of surveillance. I was simply removing myself from that equation, in that surveillance would have to be conducted on the target, either the sender or the receiver of the messages. We have a very important case in our history over in the United States. It's Smith v. Maryland. I learned about it myself quite recently. But basically what it says is that any information you trust to a service provider is no longer protected. All of the meta information associated with a phone call or an email information is no longer protected. And effectively what it means is that if you want to communicate with anybody electronically, that discussion is not protected, because you're entrusting a service provider out there in the cloud, in the ether, with those communications. And it shouldn't be that way. Simply using a service shouldn't mean giving up your rights to privacy. And that's what my service was designed to do. It was to remove me from the possibility of being forced to violate a person's privacy. Now, I lived happily for about 10 years until recently, at which point I was approached and told that because I couldn't turn over the information, I would be forced to give up those SSL keys and let the FBI collect it themselves. And again, I tried to cooperate. I tried to provide modify my system to provide the information myself for that one particular user. And the government's response was, well, we want it in real time. You mean you want to be able to log into a device on my network and change the collection parameters in real time without anybody knowing? They didn't have an answer to that. when I offered to let them put the device on my network, but stipulated that I be able to audit it, that I be able to configure it with them, and that I would hold 10 characters of the password and that they would hold 10 characters of the password, so that we'd know that this device was only collecting the information they were legally authorized to collect, they declined as well. Effectively, what they wanted was unfettered access to every communication on my network without any kind of transparency. And that was simply a situation I couldn't live with, something I wasn't comfortable with. In fact, it was such a disturbing prospect that I was having trouble sleeping. So finally, I decided, quite simply, if I didn't win the fight to unseal my case, if I didn't win the battle to be able to tell people what was going on, then my only ethical choice left was to shut down. Now, I didn't expect anybody to even notice my shutdown, sans the 400,000 or so people who were using my service. Maybe a little bit of coverage in the tech blogs. But if one thing the summer of Snowden has done for all of us, it's focused the debate on privacy. And as a result, I got a lot more coverage than I expected. It's part of the reason I'm here today, because the people on this dais, the people out in the audience, heard about what was going on and they wanted to hear more. But the discussion doesn't mean anything if it doesn't lead to action. So while my lawyers can win the battle for SSL keys, there's a larger debate about whether or not service providers can be forced to give up passwords, encryption keys, source code, their intellectual property, their crown jewels, just to aid in an investigation, or if that the burden should fall back on the investigators. Like I said, surveillance isn't supposed to be easy. It's supposed to be difficult. And what's happening is the methods that are being employed are creating effectively an arms race, forcing people who want to have private conversations to develop better and better ways of communicating, more and more secure ways. And unfortunately, what that means is that both the citizen and the criminal are using the same method of communication. And that secure method of communication is becoming harder and harder to decipher for law enforcement. And it's a prospect that effectively is being brought on by themselves. And it's unfortunate, but it's a reality. And I think I'll leave it at that.
Okay, thank you very much. Contrary to what I announced before, I will now invite Mr. Troels Oerting first, if that's okay with Jacob Appelbaum. I think because there's a very clear bridge here. There is always this contradiction that on the one hand, government says we need to protect ourselves. They're calling on the responsibility of individual citizens. The cybersecurity strategy is about securing our systems and our communications. And at the same time, those very same governments want to have access to all our data. And I think there is another interesting paradox that you just underlined. You said citizens as well as criminals are using the same protections, the same security systems. Which is indeed not what we wanted, but you know that will be the situation if governments are so intrusive. So I'm very curious to hear the views of the cybercrime unit, Mr. Oerting.
Thank you very much, Ms. Infeld, and thank you very much for inviting me here and giving me the opportunity, maybe to give you a I don't think it's a different view, but I just think it's basically not what you will hear from the other ones. But I don't think that we are so far from each other. Mr. Levison spoke about freedom that he is a heavy protector of, and you have a pal here. I think that freedom and privacy is very, very essential for all of us, and I think that we praise ourselves by living at least in democracies where we enjoy that right. But I guess that you also will be agreeing with me that if we have unlimited freedom, there might be also other issues that will appear. So it's always a balance between total freedom and total security. If you have total security, you have no freedom. Nobody wants that. So we have to find in the middle a balance to strike. And while the internet is extremely good and it will increase our growth and prosperity and transparency and connectivity. And I'm really a gadget freak myself. I think it's extraordinary, you know, purposes that we can support by having an internet. It will also give the law enforcement really unseen challenges. Remember, we are used to work in the physical offline world, and this is why the police are designed to do. This is how the MLAT system works. And that is because that in the offline world, there is always a connection between the crime and the perpetrator. If I want to kill somebody or rape somebody or rob somebody or whatever, I have to be near the location, right? It might be that I will work through other ones, but there will be a connection in this crime. And I have to travel. That's why the police, they interview, they have biometrics, they look at the crime scene and they interview witnesses and whatever. But in cybercrime, you cannot do this. Nobody travels here, they just travel virtually. So the European police forces will have to live up to a new reality where the crime will occur from outside the EU, I would guess, towards the EU, and through loads of security services and proxies and VPNs and hidden services that will make it even more difficult for us to obtain the criminal. And last but not least, I'm not a security intelligence service. I have to prove without any reasonable doubt to a judge that somebody has conducted a crime, and for that I need attribution. So the European Cybercrime Center thinks that we need to engage in four areas. First of all, it's awareness and capacity building to educate our citizens on what to do and what not to do, why they should care about their privacy, why they shouldn't share everything with everybody. And I think we have failed to a certain extent. Secondly, I think that we should then have much stronger infrastructure. We should harden the infrastructure. There should be privacy and also safety and protection by design. I think we are better here, but not to the full extent. But it's not just enough to armor the sheep, you and me. We also have to identify and hunt down the wolves. So we have to go out also to find the criminals. And that is what I'm trying to do. Then, how should we do this? I think that most of us in the EU, we are strong believers in the rule of law. We spoke about this, Appelbaum and I, just before we started here, that you should do things, if you are intrusive, in openness and transparency. Again, look at the physical world. In the physical world, I as a cop can arrest a citizen, of course based on rules, but I can arrest and take away the freedom. I can frisk his body. I can also go to his home and make house searches. If I have another suspicion, I might even be able to intercept his telephone, or I can bug his room, all because we have rules of law and transparency. But we accept this. We accept this intrusion because it's based on open laws and because we have a judge who have authorized the police. It's not just done by somebody for some reason. But it's openness, and I'm scrutinized every day by every authority in my home country or in the EU by the JSB, because we need proportionality and we need also reason to do things. So based on this, I guess we can also find a solution for how we can make us do our work on the internet, where we will have to be intrusive, of course, but hopefully only on the people who deserves that, and not on everybody, which we don't want to monitor and don't have the capacity to do. And I think also it's not right. So I believe very much there is a right to be forgotten, but there is also sometimes a need to be remembered. And if you have actually also made the possibility and the suspicion, I think that there should be this right. The discussion after the NSA and the Snowden has, as Ms. Levison said, will probably start an arms race. It will be so difficult for law enforcement to protect not states, but you, the citizens, from criminals who want to steal our information, our identity, our money, our whole digital life. And I'm not able to help anybody if I do not have tools to do so. But I don't want tools that are anonymous or hidden. I want it to be very transparent and that the society, us together, find where the balance should be. And if we want to have more criminals because we want to have more freedom, so be it. I apply to law, but I think that we need to discuss this also. And I don't think that privacy equals anonymity, because if it does, you create rooms that nobody can penetrate. And if you do so, I think we will have the Wild West. And don't for one minute believe that if I cannot, as a democratic, transparent police, secure safety, do you think that other ones will step in? I think they will. There will be loads of private companies who don't ask if they are getting paid, and you want this to go away. But do we want a digital Blackwaters on the internet, or do you want a open and transparent police? I think you want the last. But if you want so, we have to balance the debate, and we also have to get rid of the root causes for this debate, which is the surveillance of big intelligence agencies on people who might not deserve it. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for those words. I think I very much agree with them in principle, but I do think that we shouldn't only be talking about criminals, but about threats in general. And quite honestly, yeah. I do think that even our own governments are a threat to our rights, because if you weigh this against the possibilities for legal redress, legal protection of our civil rights, I mean, just yesterday we were listening to judges of the European Human Rights Courts in Strasbourg. Basically, as a citizen, you get lost in this judicial jungle, so you have no effective protection. And in this sense, if you talk about the Wild West, I mean, quite honestly, the methods of the U.S. government remind me of the Wild West more than a democratic society and rule of law. Okay, then I'm going to invite Mr. Jacob Appelbaum as our third speaker. You have the floor for about 10 minutes.
Great. Thanks so much for having me back. It's really a great honor to be able to come back here again, and it's really wonderful to meet everyone else on this panel that I haven't met before. I wanted to try to talk a little bit about technology in the actual sense of talking about some of the technical details. So one of these common points that we hear in common, both from the European cyber crime people as well as the NSA, is that they need to be able to watch to keep us safe. And in principle, I think most people agree that to some degree is true. That is, if they're going to be keeping us safe, then they have to be watching us. But I think one of the core problems is that actually we don't get safety by them watching us. Certainly not the NSA. I mean, I'm sure Belgacom does not feel particularly safe right now, and they were heavily watched. So it isn't merely the case that surveillance alone will bring safety. Sometimes we make trade-offs. So for example, there is a way to configure a web service in what is called forward secret modes. That is, the web service or the transport layer security service actually offers a cryptographic mode where you identify yourself. That is, the server says, I'm Lavabit, as an example. And then this service generates a random key, and then this key is, hopefully if it's configured properly, it's destroyed at the end of the session. This is really important because what it means is that dragnet surveillance is thwarted even if they're able to extract this identity key. It isn't the case that it is always configured in this way. And this is a policy thing which I think the European Union could push forward, which is making sure that the technology that is configured in this way, that's what we would call secure. We wouldn't call it secure unless it was configured in this way. And this is something which can be audited. There's a really great website run by, I think it's Ivan Ristic, SSL probe. It's the Qualys SSL probe. And you can actually run it on services. You give it a URL, and it'll tell you a grade. You know, a lot of websites, they get an F, for example. Lots of services get a very poor grade. This will, of course, make it very difficult to do surveillance because you can't just go to the provider and make them an agent of the state in secret anymore. Then I think so. In this regard, this kind of technical change can actually ensure that the things that we don't want, let's say dragnet surveillance, that they're significantly more difficult to do. And I think this is important for individual, particular surveillance. You can still, of course, do an attack on this person. You can still surveil a particular person, but it's very, very difficult to get everybody all at once retroactively. And that is to say, right now, if you get this special key, if you were to get, for example, Ladar's SSL key for Lavabit, if the FBI had been recording all the traffic going into his service and he were to be forced to give it up, he's not just forced to give up the future. he's forced to give up the past as well. And this is a new, this I think is actually a new thing, which is an egregious retroactive policing that we should be extremely skeptical of, especially when we consider the NSA's broad wiretapping, which is to say, if they're recording a great deal of traffic on the internet all the time, the only thing that stands between them making sense of that illegally captured data and not is this key. And therefore, it's very important that at least if they're going to, in the long run, get the key, we would like it, I would like it, such that that key is worthless, except moving forward for active, specific active targeted surveillance. And I think a really key thing is to make sure that the laws let the person under surveillance know that they're being spied on. And this is a very controversial thing, I suspect, with police who like to operate in the shadows. So there certainly is the case that if we have this, it will change behaviors. But so too when people were being followed, right? I mean, when people saw a policeman sitting outside their house writing down license plate numbers of cars that parked there, people knew that that was taking place. And so when we discuss this idea of consent, we need to consider that we have not arrived in a perfect surveillance state where we actually had a debate and a discussion about it. What happened is that we slowly got here, and along the way there were very reasonable discussions, and then we found out we actually were somewhere totally different. And this is not something that we consent to. I actually don't think that the police have the right to do complete dragnet surveillance, and I actually don't think they should have the right to do it in secret, because there's almost no difference qualitatively and quantitatively between cyber criminals, so-called, and what the NSA is doing. And if you can't tell the difference between the methods and the tactics and the strategy of the state and criminals, you're in serious trouble with your state, especially when your state starts to target you. So, you know, to that end, I would offer a very simple analogy. I mean, poaching is a really big problem, for example. And I think we'd all agree that surveilling areas like a wildlife preserve where there are some animals that would be endangered, it's an important thing to do. But we need to be proportionate. So to get rid of the poachers, you don't want to firebomb the cheetahs, right? We need to make sure that we actually safeguard our liberty. And we don't simply give it up, because it's a false trade-off to do this. So we should find ways of dealing with the serious problems, let's say the poachers, without getting rid of the actual prized thing that we care about, which is liberty itself. So to that end, we should not really talk about data protection, but people protection. Datenschutz is a really strange term to me, because it is not data that needs protection. Data that the state has unfettered access to is not private just because we perceive it to be private. Quite the opposite. It is actually in the hands of the people who can do the most harm with it in some cases. And I think it is also important to get rid of data retention, period. Full stop. And the reason is because we are creating a sort of Exxon Valdez situation or a data Valdez situation where at some point someone will get access to this data and they'll dump it and they'll put it online. And even though it will be a crime to keep a copy of it, it will still be out there, and you will not be able to take this back. So getting rid of data retention actually reduces really serious amounts of liability which we're taking on. So what Lavabit did is brilliant. They said, we are not required by law to keep this data, and we don't want to betray our users, so we're not going to keep it. And as a result, when the FBI acted beyond their legal scope, at least what I think is, I'm not a lawyer, and I'm definitely not Ladar's lawyer, but I know Ladar's lawyer, and she's really good. Good luck on that, by the way. And I think it's important to recognize that the FBI is going to go as far as they can. The NSA is going to go as far as they can. And because in many cases they operate in secret, having this data there at all means that it will be abused. An example of this is the NSA's love int, their so-called love intelligence, where NSA agents spied on people that they had crushes on, or that they were married to, or that they were divorcing from. Right, so this is an example of just one very small abuse of this data, but it can be huge. And imagine if you were one of the people targeted by that program and you tried to talk about it with someone, people would think you were crazy. Well, the thing is that the more people that have access to this data, the worse it becomes. And it also attracts the worst kind of people. So let's say only good people want to be police officers today. What happens when they have access to this data? Some not so great people with some very different intentions will now have access to this. So that's a big policy change. that I think is important. And we should also look at the discussion between strategic surveillance and tactical surveillance. That is to say, whole population surveillance is something which should probably not be done. This is something which we, if we can outlaw it, I think we should, just completely. And tactical surveillance is a thing we cannot stop, but economics limits it. But it doesn't limit it very much from the perspective of the state. So for example, this idea of bugging someone's house is absolutely an affront, because it means that a person has no place in their whole life where they can lay their head down and feel free if they suspect themselves to be under these kinds of surveillance regimes. And I personally have experienced that myself. I cannot remember the last time that I went to bed and thought I could freely talk in that place, or even think of what was in my head out loud. And that comes from the fact that the law does not limit a budget that is unbelievable for these kinds of surveillance operations. It doesn't limit it. It would be possible. It would even be something they could bring in a court. So this kind of limit is something I think, if we're going to have a state that does help us, one of the things it should do is to tell us that we have some liberty, not just in our homes, but actually in the activities we do. So when we call someone and they happen to be in the same house, just because we have to use a cell phone that routes outside of the house, we shouldn't lose our assumption of privacy. This Smith versus Maryland was used in my legal case as well, Ladar, USA v. Appelbaum, which is the Twitter case that I was a part of. And they said that if you, you know, disclose the phone number to the phone company, you have no expectation of privacy. But this is, I think, just a completely crazy thing. Especially because the people that are impacted by these things rarely know that they're impacted by it. So to that end, I wanted to say there's this really fantastic book, which is called The Real World of Technology. It's by Ursula M. Franklin. She's a Canadian physicist. And I wanted to recommend that everyone here reads this book. I'm about halfway through it, so I can't say that it's, you know, I've read every part of the book, but every single time I read a page, I basically earmark it because it has some brilliant thing in it. And I guess I'd like to close by saying that we sort of live in the golden age of surveillance. But I've noticed a really interesting discussion point, which is that what people used to call liberty and freedom, we now call privacy. And we say, in the same breath, that privacy is dead. This is something that really concerns me about my generation, especially when we talk about how we're not surprised by anything. It's a generation of total cynical downers in some ways. And I think that we should consider that when we lose privacy, we lose agency. We lose liberty itself, because we no longer feel free to express what we think. And I was at a protest recently in Berlin, a Freiheit statt Angst protest, where there was a poster of a person who said out loud, yes, but in their head, in a thought bubble, it said no. And I feel like that perfectly encapsulates what's actually happening here, which is that people are even afraid to say that they're afraid, because they understand the chilling effects that come from this. And just because a judge who does not understand technology signs off on it, that does not actually make me feel better. Just because, for example, in Holland, it's something like 62 out of every 100,000 people are wiretapped. Just because a judge signed off on those things doesn't make me feel good. The FISA court also signed off, if you can call it a court, the FISA court also signed off on dragnet surveillance of the whole planet. Somehow that doesn't bring me any peace, especially when these judges barely read their own email. They have a secretary that prints it out for them. They think the internet is something that comes on foot. This does not bring me any sort of peace. And to that end, I want to make sure that we don't, you know, and my last point here is to say there's this myth of the passive surveillance machine. But actually, what is surveillance except control? I'm sorry to plagiarize Foucault here, but it's extremely important to understand that the NSA deployed their massive surveillance machine against Iraq before the Iraq War and during the Iraq War. They killed over 100,000 people illegally in that war. How many people have terrorists killed if you don't count the US government amongst them? I'll tell you, this is something that really bothers me. This notion that surveillance exists in a vacuum is nonsense. And that the NSA are passive, this is nonsense. What we see with Belgacom is that they actively attack European citizens, American citizens, and in fact, anyone that they can if they perceive an advantage. They leave us purposefully vulnerable, and then they exploit that vulnerability, and then they pass that information along, not just for the purposes of an illegal war, but they use it in drone strikes as well. So think about it this way. America's assassination program is directly linked with the NSA surveillance. maybe we need to change the fundamental architecture that allows that to be possible. And we need to think surveillance is control. And one of the most extreme forms of control is outright murder. And that is what my government is engaged in right now. And this is something which Ladar is fighting, I think, quite well, and I hope that he wins. But this is really what we are getting at here, which is it's not an abstract thing. It's directly and concretely tied to this. And we'll see this in the future. There will be things that show this, that the NSA surveillance and drone strikes are tied together. And so that's thousands and thousands of people murdered without a trial, without a judge. And this surveillance is an so-called legal or authorized surveillance. So I think it's totally out of hand. And with some technical changes, we can really make some big differences that change the economics. And when we change the economics, we can force the policy to actually shift in line with what people in a democracy would like. So thank you.
Thank you very much for giving us food for thought. You mentioned budgets and the economics. Just yesterday, I received a reply by the European Commission to a question. This House adopted about 2 years ago a resolution calling for an in-depth evaluation of counterterrorism policies, including the cost. I mean, not saying do we spend too much or too little, but just asking how much do we actually spend on it, because nobody really seems to know. You get the impression that it's huge amounts of money, but then, you know, we're in the middle of an economic crisis, so we've got plenty of money to spend on these things. And the reply of the Commission was, well, we don't actually need to evaluate, we don't need to investigate, because this is all for security, so we shouldn't even be asking the question. Besides, nobody really knows how much we spend. Okay, this is the official reply of the European Commission. You citizens are not supposed to know, you're not even supposed to ask. So now you know. We'll post the letter on Twitter later this afternoon. Okay, we're going to listen to our last speaker of today. Mr. Heather, you have the floor for about 10 minutes.
Thank you. My name's James Heather. I work at the University of Surrey in the UK. I do research into... Well, I started out applying formal methods to security protocols, and I've drifted over the last few years into applying some of that stuff to electronic voting, by which I don't mean internet voting, but in poll station voting electronically. I will come back to that later because I think it provides an informative case study for some of the things that we're talking about here. In a way, what I want to do is to expand on something that Jacob finished with, where he mentioned this tactic of making people deliberately vulnerable and then exploiting it. That, for me, is where it gets the scariest, and that's what I want to focus on. But I want to start by taking a little bit of a step backward. I'm an academic, so I want to give you an academic perspective on this thing and on what the academic community does in terms of crypto research. It used to be that if you wanted to create an encryption system, basically you came up with something that was obscure as you could manage, and then you sat back and you said, well, I can't see a way to crack that, so let's hope that nobody else can. Things have moved on substantially. And now what we do is we design systems that we can prove to be secure by construction. That is a huge step forward methodologically, because what we have is something that's much stronger than no one's managed to crack this yet. But now we have, I can prove that no one can crack this, not even the NSA. The footnote, of course, is that all of these proofs are based on assumptions that may or may not hold. And what this episode has done for me, I think, is to open my eyes a bit more as to whether some of those assumptions are realistic enough or not. So these proofs happen in two separate areas. One is on cryptographic primitives, which is to say how an encryption system works, and you have proofs that say this encryption system is secure, brackets, provided that, dot, dot, dot. The other place it works is with security protocols, something like SSL that Ladar talked about, where we prove that this protocol is secure, brackets, provided that, dot, dot, dot. And this dot, dot, dot generally involves reducing something to an assumption that we all believe is true. It's not proven, but we all believe it to be true. And they come out in various ways. Sometimes it's a mathematical statement about how difficult a problem is to solve. Sometimes it's about how you implement these things properly. So, for example, an encryption system might be secure provided that I have decent randomness going into the process that I use to generate my keys. That's an assumption that we don't normally question, that we don't normally think about, because we think, well, that's easy, that's obvious. And this is one of the things that this whole Snowden episode has shed some light on. So one of the issues that was picked up on was the NSA deliberately weakening a standard for how you generate random numbers. Now, if you can do that, all bets are off, because any system that you use needs to take some random input to generate its keys. Now I have known information coming out of my random generator going into my key generation, so now my keys are predictable as well. Maybe I can give you a little case study to think about to show where some of these issues pan out and to show you the good side of some of this and the potential bad side of it. And the case study I'd like to use is electronic voting. Electronic voting, when it works and when it's properly secure, is far, far better than anything that we use at the moment. By electronic voting, I mean properly crypto-secure voting. I don't mean DREs, where you just press on the name of the person you want to vote for and then it just adds one to that counter. I mean properly secure by academic standards. At the moment, you go into a polling station, you fill in a little piece of paper, or you press a button, the system somehow records your vote, you hope, and then you go away, and your participation ends. You see a tally come up later on your television, and you presumably believe that your vote added one to one of those numbers, but you don't know. What you can get with some of these crypto techniques is a system where I can now go home and prove to myself that my vote really was included in the tally. I can even go and prove to somebody else that my vote's been changed and query the tally of the election without revealing how I voted. And that's a really powerful thing. It protects against some of the things that we've seen around the world, well, for a long time, but in particular in the last couple of weeks, Azerbaijan has reached the ultimate efficiency modification in its election of not even needing to cast the votes at all, because you announce the results before the election happens. It prevents that kind of thing happening. So you get much stronger properties than you ever had with your paper. But that's provided that your assumptions hold about what's going into your system. So that will include an assumption that my cryptographic standard for my system hasn't been broken and hasn't been deliberately manipulated. It will include that my random number generator that's used to generate the keys for my election hasn't been broken. To some extent, it will include an implication that the implementation hasn't been tampered with, although we have some protections against that, at least for the integrity of the election, if not for the secrecy of the election. The problem is that if those assumptions fail, what you have now is a system that is far, far worse than you ever dreamt of. Can you imagine how difficult it would be to throw an election on a large scale when you've got people from all over a big country filling in pieces of paper and putting them in boxes? It's actually quite difficult. You've got to corrupt a lot of people and you've got to corrupt a lot of processes. If you're doing all of this electronically, now one change to one line of code and you can reveal everybody's election, everybody's vote. Or potentially you can change the result of the election. So if your assumptions fail, you end up in a really bad place. If your assumptions hold true, then you end up somewhere better than you had in your current ballot box system. That is why, for me, where this whole episode of revelations about the NSA and so on, where that has crossed a red line is in the deliberate weakening of cryptographic standards that we have come to trust. So the random number generator in particular is the major one that's been revealed. That seems to me to be a huge problem, that you have, exactly as Jacob says, you have the NSA deliberately making people vulnerable by making them trust something that's broken and then exploiting it later. We don't know how far this goes, because not everything's been revealed yet. Are there other even more widely used cryptographic primitives out there that we trust in that are now broken that we don't know about yet? Don't know. And if there's a silver lining to some of this, I have to say that one of the things that gave me a bit of comfort was the NSA's attitude to Lavabit and its intention to beat it into the dust and hand over its SSL keys. Because that tells me two things. One, they haven't broken SSL, otherwise they wouldn't need to get the SSL keys. And two, they haven't broken the underlying encryption scheme that's behind SSL. So that means they haven't broken the RSA, I assume, behind the public key, and they haven't broken the AES encryption that's used to encrypt the data stream after you've done your initial setup phase.
No, so, I wasn't using the hardware extensions.
Okay. Okay.
Sorry, I distracted him.
So there are some things that I can now have more trust in that the NSA hasn't broken, because I can see from their behavior that there are certain things they can't do, otherwise they wouldn't have tried this bullying stuff. I do have this slight worry, though, that for all that I'm pleased that this has raised the level of public debate on this, and for all that it's opened up lots of questions, and for all that it, I hope, will lead towards a more transparent system, I do think there is a grain of truth to this claim that some damage has been done by it. Because if I were a terrorist, I would now have much clearer ideas of how I was going to organize my communication so that the NSA couldn't read it. And I am just slightly worried about that. I hope that the good that comes out of this will outweigh that. But I do think there are some issues about what we have now given to the bad guys in the process of revealing all of this. But as I say, for all of the really bad behavior that's gone on behind this, the one that worries me most is this deliberate weakening of standards so that they can be exploited later. Because you don't know who else has managed to find exploits for these weaknesses that you've put into these cryptographic standards.
Thank you very much. And I'm sure that this has given, you know, more, that it has given information to the bad guys. But I think what it has done, which is a lot more serious, is undermining trust in governments and undermining trust in the internet, in communications, in the chilling effect, I think, is one of the worst fallout of all of this. And then if everybody's always justifying this kind of programs by pointing at the risk of or the threat of terrorism. But, you know, nobody's been able to explain to me so far why the NSA was eavesdropping on the commission headquarters in Washington or the office of the Brazilian president. You know, what on earth does that have to do with terrorism? Or why, indeed, the British secret services are wiretapping the European Parliament? I mean, you know, some people have funny views in this house, but it doesn't make them a terrorist. So this is all, it's always a pretext. You know, there is not a terrorist on every street corner. Terrorists have always been around. They probably always will. So that is not a justification of unlimited powers based on secret laws, supervised by secret courts on the basis of secret budgets. That is not something that we should tolerate in a democratic society. So before I open the floor for debate, I would like to come back to Mr. Oerting, though, and ask him a question, because you would investigate cases of, let's say, cyber crime, criminals who are after our money, fraud, cases like that. But we know now that Europol or your cybercrime unit has not been asked by any member state to investigate the allegations of, let's say, backdoors having been created in the service of service of SWIFT, the company in charge of bank transfers. We know there are other cases involving Belgacom right here in Brussels. As far as I know, Europol cybercrime unit has not been asked to investigate such cases. But would you be? Have you ever been asked to investigate cases where the suspicion was against, let's say, the Chinese or the Russian government?
Thank you very much. No, not to my knowledge have we been involved in any of these suspicions so far. And I think it's because that state-sponsored activity seems to be out of our mandate for some reason or another, that what we're looking for is ordinary criminals and not so much. And I think it requires a change of our legal framework if we should assist the member states. It is, of course, an intrusion of a critical infrastructure, and that's evident. But the purpose for doing this is not crime. And in our legal framework, as you probably know, we have identified what kind of actions that we can support, and that is only linked to organized traditional crime and not the other things. So I think that will require some kind of a change. And maybe also, if you want so, to include something that we have in a right of initiative ourselves and don't have to wait for other ones if there is a suspicion of critical infrastructure intrusion. But right now, it's a blank no.
Okay, thank you. I think that indeed we should be discussing this. We've also tabled amendments to that effect because I think it is rather peculiar. I mean, you know, whether crime is state-sponsored or not, it's still crime and it's still about our security. So I think that we should, you know, and I think citizens are not going to make the distinction. They just want to be kept safe. And that's why we have your unit. Okay, I'm going to open the floor to questions and debate. You know the routine. I already see one hand going up. You raise your hand. I'll point at you, and you can take the floor for about 1 minute. Please state who you are, unless you don't feel like doing so. and preferably state whom you're addressing your question to. Okay, I saw one request in the back of the room, the gentleman over there.
Hello, my name is Nicolas Petiot. I'm a computing science teacher at the École Supérieure d'Informatique, 1 kilometer from here, and also at University of Brussels. I would like to address you a question. Knowing that the European institutions have been tapped by NSA or Britain, do you know if any legal action has been taken?
Okay, I'll answer that question, but I'm going to round up a couple of questions as we usually do, three or four, and then we'll answer them in batches. I saw another one over here.
Andrei Grabins, Research Executive Agency. We were discussing here mainly the private issue, but I think that business issues might be even larger in a threat. I'll just mention shortly the case of Echelon, which is known from years now, where the Airbus has been taped, actually by Americans and UK secret services, and aircraft lost a billion jobs in China. I think this is even larger leverage of the threats that we see. So we should consider this. I think you particularly in the legislation. Thank you.
Thank you. So economic espionage. Any, yeah, over here.
Yeah, Peter. I also want to add some things which I missed in the discussion. And that has to do with evidence can be made up. So if you want to catch criminals, I'm not a criminal, but I'm criminalized, and there's a possibility that evidence is found in my computer, which I didn't put there. So I missed that in the discussion. I miss also the connection between control and murder, the drone possibilities are not only complied to murder physically, but also for the possibilities of eliminating people having access and cooperate, just take part of society, especially with biometrics and all the identification numbers we are at the moment. That's what I wanted to say, anyway.
Okay, thank you. Any further questions for this round? Not yet. Everybody's still warming up. Okay, I'll start first with the question of the gentleman in the back. I don't know all the details, but to my knowledge, the Belgian public prosecutor has opened the case, is investigating the case of allegations of Belgacom having been, let's say, hacked or used. In that case, Belgacom would therefore be the victim. The interesting bit, as far as I know, and I think there are people from Belgacom in the room, so if anybody wants me to correct me, feel free to do so. But as far as I know, Belgacom itself has no information about the details of the case. It's closed. It's secret. However, we discussed this in the public hearing, and one of my colleagues suggested that, given that we are all customers of Belgacom, or at least make use of services of Belgacom and its affiliates, that we too could be considered to be victims, and that the European Parliament, for example, could consider taking legal steps. I don't think we are quite there yet, but it was a very interesting thought that met with a great deal of interest. I'm going to ask you, I think, to answer the question particularly about, because I felt you moving next to me about, constructing evidence against somebody, and all the others can come in on the issues you want to come into, and economic espionage as well.
Thank you very much, Sophie. It's completely right. We have organized criminal groups and criminals who steal your identity for two purposes. And normally because they use your identity to conduct crime in, and you will maybe get the blame and they will conduct the crime. But we have also seen cases where evidence has been fabricated. So maybe to put some kind of stains on you, maybe you plant child sexual abuse pictures on your computer, then you cannot really can justify. And afterwards, there is a tip to the police, and they will see, and then they will go through all the evidences. So you will see that there are things like that. And this is also what concerns us, of course, is that we don't want anybody to be responsible for others' crime. And so I think it's of great concern. Again, technically, what I always fear is that the prisons are filled with the most stupid criminals, right? Not the clever ones, unfortunately, because we are never able to catch them. So we catch the stupid ones. And that requires some more, you know, intellectual work and also more sophisticated police work. And I think that in these areas, we will see a big challenge in the future, because there is corruption, there is people who want to blame politicians for things they haven't done during election campaigns and whatever. And you will see this also being used in the future. You will see fake Facebook sites, you know, belonging to people who state this and that, fake Twitter accounts and other things, which is enabling people to be stained. And I think this is a concern. This is also about privacy, but it's also about criminality. And this is done for a purpose.
Yeah, but the police in the Netherlands, they want to give access to all the computers. Yeah.
Okay, I think we understand the question. But maybe before I ask the others to come back, I think I'd like to elaborate on that question. What if it isn't identity thieves who are fabricating evidence against you, but what if it is the public authorities themselves, the police, judiciary, or intelligence services? How can you defend yourself against such, state-sponsored identity theft? I mean, I don't see killer drones flying around Brussels just yet. Yeah? We're not in that stage yet. But if I see the length at which governments are willing to go, then you cannot exclude this. So how then in this day and age with the state of the technology, can people protect themselves against something like that? Because that would also be a crime. That would be identity theft. Therefore, it would be in your department. But would you be able and allowed to investigate something like that?
No, again, I have to refer to the previous answer, that this is, if this is done as part of a state-sponsored activity, I think we are singled out immediately for that. We are fighting organized crime, and the national security issues is others. So I would have to, if we got a case, I would have to send it back and say, we cannot deal with it, we're not allowed to.
Okay, so basically, if a state commits a crime in the name of national security, there's nothing more we can do. Jacob.
So two things. What is the state that is criminal if not organized crime? That's my first thought. And then my second thought is, I just had the opportunity to testify in Gottfried Svartholm's case in Sweden. He's one of the founders of the Pirate Bay, and he's, I guess, Sweden's most prominent political prisoner. He's also one of the greatest hackers to ever live. He was basically kidnapped from Cambodia by the Swedish government. And when I asked Carl Bildt in person why this happened, he said that it was legal. And I said, well, under which law? It's not legal in Cambodian law. It's not legal under international law. And does Sweden have a law in the books that says that you're allowed to kidnap a Swedish citizen from anywhere on the planet? And he said it was legal. And I said, well, is it legal because you said it's legal or because there's a law? And he said, it's legal. That's literally what he said. And the thing is that in Anakata's case, Sapo, the Swedish police, they did a forensics report on his machine, and they said that there was no possibility for remote control. That is, they didn't see any evidence of remote control. The fact that they used this term when discussing it tells you that the forensics people are so incompetent as to barely be able to breathe in the digital space. It's embarrassing. It's so embarrassing, it's surprising. Specifically because his computer was set up as a virtual private networking server. Meaning, anyone that had access to this machine could log in and send data as if it were his computer, and they noted this in the evidence and said that the evidence of this was evidence that it had not happened. The exact opposite of what the evidence says. Because of my testimony and the testimony of some other people, he was acquitted of this particular charge, but then the court decided that it couldn't have happened that his computer would be so-called remote controlled for such a long period of time without him noticing. So they convicted him of a different crime relating to the same computer, but not the later crime, basically. And this is an example of how they're actually having a political judgment and using this evidence to put someone away because they don't like him. Because the evidence is clear that it was a shared lab computer, and they decided that it was something totally different. And this is because they don't understand it. And the Swedish police, who are, in fact, looking at this evidence, they don't even do a full investigation. And this is the critical point, they don't give the evidence to the defense. I was not allowed to actually see the evidence. I was only allowed to look at the report. So what we see even in Europe is that the evidence that is used against a person in a court of law, allegedly a court of law, you're not allowed to see it. You're not allowed to confront these people. And in fact, to testify in Anakata's defense, I had to be interrogated by the police for something like an hour and a half before I would be allowed into the court. So this is something which is just totally an affront. I was very surprised to experience this in a European court. And Anakata is still in jail now. He's been in jail for over a year at this point.
Okay, thank you.
I have a number of comments here left over from when the other speaker spoke, but one of the things that I flagged was what Jacob said about how when you can't differentiate the methods employed by criminal organizations and governments, how do you differentiate between the two? Who's a criminal and who's acting on behalf of the state? And that's the problem that we have, is that our security systems were designed to protect us from criminals. They weren't designed to protect us from our own governments. And what we have now is a world in which governments are acting as criminals. And our security systems weren't designed to protect us against that. And we're sort of left in this situation that Heather spoke of, which is that we don't know who to trust and what we can trust, what is safe, what will protect us, what will protect our communications from a determined attacker with unlimited resources, willing to spend and devote all of them to breaking the security and the protections surrounding it. And it's a very disturbing prospect when you walk into a store and you don't know what you can buy because you don't know what has been compromised. And that's the world that we live in today. And, you know, I'll just kind of add by talking about the business implications of that and how, at least in the U.S., given the current climate, you know, we can't trust any of the technology vendors in the U.S. anymore because we don't know who's working with the NSA and who isn't. So we're left with a situation in which we can't trust anyone, and we have to look abroad for products and services that presumably we can still trust.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Heather?
Yeah, to some extent, I don't think this is new, really. Governments have always had a huge amount of power and sufficient power to be able to frame any individual that they want, more or less, for any crime that they want. The fact that they can now do it in the digital world is worrying, but it's worrying that they can do it in the physical world, and that's always been the case for thousands of years. So I don't see this really as a new thing. It's just the same worrying problem that we've always had. There was a question about business espionage. I think that's quite an interesting one. And I think there is a major danger here, because if we're now starting to see government agencies browbeating private enterprise into handing over data, that opens up a whole new line of business espionage. So if the government can nobble a smartphone manufacturer, they might say, give us all your data or we'll do bad things to you. What they might say is, give us access to all of your customers' data, and in return, we will give you some information that gives you a market edge over your competitors, so that you could get state-sponsored business espionage in order to get data out of private companies. That would be quite worrying. I don't know that that's happening, but it doesn't seem many steps removed from the things that we assumed weren't happening and it turns out are happening.
Yes, thanks. I'm not sure if, I haven't made up my mind yet if anything has changed in the digital era, or if it's all, you know, like it used to be, but just bigger. Because I do think that there's some, well, you talked about assumptions that aren't safe anymore. For example, if I'm an innocent citizen, I can, you know, fairly safely assume that the Secret Services will not bother to bug my house, for example. But I cannot use that assumption anymore in the digital era. And they may wish to monitor me for all sorts of reasons, much more easily than, you know, when they actually had to break into my home and install microphones and what have you.
Yeah, so it may be that the level of power that states have is now higher than it was comparative to the physical world, or lower than it was. It's still huge, and it always was huge. I suppose that's what I'm saying.
I'm curious about something. You said that this is not new, and I think this is part of a coping mechanism that we hear a lot in public. But last time I checked, Booz Allen and Hamilton hasn't been around for the entire time the United States has. That is to say, we've privatized huge parts of the spying, given people special clearances, and then they're not held accountable to the same standard as civil servants. I think that's actually very new. And whole population surveillance, parsing, and data retention is very new. That is to say that we are part of the last generation of human beings alive where it was not the case that we were being collected on for the whole of our life. And that is not true. If you have a child today in America, until we turn this ship around, we actually will have children that are born into a complete surveillance state where they have no Fourth Amendment right to privacy, no Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination, and effectively this nullifies their First and Second Amendment rights to free speech and bear arms, respectively. So, I mean, is it really the case that nothing is new in your view?
Okay, we're going to come back to that, if I may, because I saw there's another question from the audience. There are two questions from the audience. First, Paul.
Thank you. My name is Paul Breitbart. I work for the Dutch Data Protection Authority. I've got two questions, both mainly for Mr. Oerting. First of all, if we cannot make a distinction between criminals anymore, whether they are state-sponsored or not? How do we know whether Europol or EC3 can carry out the investigation? What kind of checks can you carry out to see whether there is a question of state-sponsored investigations, state-sponsored crime going on? How would you know when you are starting an investigation? Second of all, you spoke about the need for legislation to make also cybercrime investigations more transparent and the police more accountable. What sort of legislation are you thinking about, especially trying to restore in what in my point is the essentials of the rule of law, which is the presumption of innocence? How will you restore that in an online era?
Thanks. I think that first question is particularly pertinent in view of the investigations into what happened exactly at Belgacom, because it wasn't established from day one that it was let's say state-sponsored hacking. So that's a very pertinent question, Mr. Buttarelli.
Yes, thanks, Giovanni Buttarelli, member of the European Data Protection Supervisor. Question particularly to Mr. Levison and/or Appelbaum. How much the current encryption techniques are robust enough to resist against massive or targeted surveillance in cases where backdoors are not installed or where there is no cooperation from the users or provider side? In other words, where we are in terms of alternative techniques to secure information in the mid long term.
Thank you. I'll add. I see another question in the back.
Hello, my name is Matthias Vermeulen, and I have two questions. The first one is for Mr. Appelbaum. One of the revelations we have learned about is the Fox Asset system, which, as far as I understand, has been used to detect individual Tor users. Now, could you explain how this system could be used against non-Tor users as well? Then the second question is for Mr. Oerting. Do you think personally that the European Cybercrime Center should have the competence to investigate NSA surveillance practices in the EU? And perhaps the answer can be as simple as a yes or no. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'll add in a further question to all of you, if I may, but in particular to Mr. Oerting. There is talk, I mean, some people are in favor of a ban on encryption. They feel individual citizens should not have the right to use encryption to protect themselves. Now, that may be, make life easier for police forces or intelligence services, but at the same time, we become even more vulnerable against, let's say, government surveillance or government attacks of any kind, and criminals indeed. So I wonder how you feel about that. So I think we have a whole range of questions now. I'm going to take you from left to right. Mr. Heather first.
Well, let me start with that last one. That sounds rather like telling me that I'm not allowed to lock my front door. It's not just the state that I'm worried about if I'm not allowed to use encryption. The guy in the office next to me might be doing anything with my internet traffic as it's leaving my machine and as it's coming back to my machine. I think chaos would ensue in much the same way that it would do if you banned locks on front doors. There's a question about what encryption the NSA could and couldn't hack. It seems fairly clear to me that the weak point is not in the encryption, and that the weak point is generally in what happens to data before it's encrypted or after it's decrypted. I do not think that the NSA can break RSA with large public keys. I do not think that they can defeat AES with decent-sized keys. The way that they have been getting round systems, at least as it's been reported in the popular press, is by persuading companies to give up the unencrypted data rather than by snooping on encrypted data and then decrypting it. If they could do that, then that's what they would do, because it would be far simpler and would involve telling fewer people what they were doing.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Levison.
Yeah, I was just going to expand on that and he stole most of what I was going to say, but it's generally believed that the cryptographic primitives, that the core cryptographic algorithms are secure, and that's what's being attacked are the implementations, developing or intentionally inserting weaknesses into the libraries that implement those algorithms. And that's where things become slightly more nefarious, because if you think about how most encryption, or not most, but a lot of encryption these days is done in hardware, you know, where there is no transparency into the implementation, we have no idea if the chips in our computers are actually producing a truly random stream of numbers, or if the extensions that were recently added to Intel chips and AMD chips to do AES are actually implementing the algorithm correctly in such a way that it can't be broken. And when you hear about stories of our governments coming in and intentionally inserting vulnerabilities, and you couple that with the lack of transparency into commercial products, you're left with a position of you don't know what is trustworthy and what isn't. You know that the cryptographic primitive is, but you don't know whose implementation of it can truly be trusted. I think I'll throw in another comment on another completely unrelated topic. At least in the U.S., what I found very disturbing about all of the revelations that have come out this summer is the fact that our own members of Congress didn't know what kind of surveillance was being conducted, what the capabilities of their own government that they were approving budgets for were. And to me, that's the most disturbing part. You know, I can, to a certain extent, understand the need to keep certain capabilities secret from the American people, but to also be keeping them secret from members of Congress was the most disturbing part, because now you're left with a world where there is truly no transparency, truly no supervision, so to speak, and you're basically left with a large, you know, organized organization that is going out and conducting what we, I think we all believe are criminal acts. Now, I say criminal acts in the sense that if they were acting independently and on their own, what they would be doing would be against the law. It's the fact that they've given themselves immunity that they're not being prosecuted. And so we have to ask ourselves, if it's against the law, it's against the law because it's wrong. So if it's wrong, then why is it okay for a government to do things that we think are wrong? And that's a discussion we need to have as a society.
Yeah, thanks. I think the answer to that is always, well, the answer to everything is always national security.
It's nice to have a catch-all.
Yeah, exactly. National security is a very broad notion, incidentally. Mr. Oerting.
Thank you very much. And I agree with that. And I'm trying actually desperately to separate national security from fighting crime, because I'm in the crime fighting. I'm not in the other side. And I'm happy here, I would say, to fight organized criminal networks. So Mr. Breitbart's question about how can we see the difference? It is obviously in this field a difficulty to always see the motive for some kind of attack. It could be a 16-year script kiddie, could be a foreign state, could be organized crime, it could be whatever. But along the road, there is signs what the motive was. And when we get cases, and we work predominantly in the European Cybercrime Center by supporting member states in three areas, this is intrusion, this is online fraud and child sexual exploitation. And we always ask to have a specification on what is the suspicion here behind. So nobody can just say, here we have a case and investigate it. There needs to be a suspicion. And you also know that we in Europol, and I think everything is about trust here. If I sense now that there is a distrust between the public and the state, and if that breaks, we're really in big trouble, I think. And that's why I'm pledging for that we have tools, but there is trust because you know what we are doing and you can oversee me when I do anything. And I know that Mr. Breitbart has been overseeing me personally in Europol and looking at why do you have this stored and why do you have that stored and come up with an explanation for that. And I'm happy with this system because I think this is what gives trust that I can do my job. So I think it's trust, and then of course we have to be careful about what kinds of cases we accept in these areas. And intrusion right now, it's big botnets. It's operated by Eastern European organized criminal networks, and they're generating loads of money. Online payment, it's loads of point of sale, it's loads of credit card skimming, where they use it for flight tickets or for hotel, and then it's near-field communication, which is coming up now that we are trying to see if we can prevent, and child sexual exploitation. Unfortunately, an endless number of cases in this, and which I, as a father, have difficulties by understanding, but that is actually the case. So encryption, somebody asked of encryption, I think it's legal. I agree very much with Heather that this is your front door lock, and you should, if you are feeling more vulnerable, you should put more locks on the door. I don't want anybody to make it easy for anybody to actually enter anybody's privacy. And if I have to do it, it is difficult that we have to find a way to do it if it's lawful. And it's only lawful interception we want. And I think there is a separation here. Can we do more in cybercrime to reestablish trust? I think this is part of the work we are doing right now, to try to come up with examples of what is needed and what might be out of order and illegal, and then deal with it in a public debate. How much does the state need to monitor us? I'm not monitoring anybody. I'm trying to fight crime based on a suspicion against an individual person. And that's much different than monitoring a whole group of people for something that they might do. But that's because it's a different area. That's national security. And the discussion here is much more difficult. For me, I'm just trying to separate it because all of us wants to live in a safe and have a safe internet, also free and transparent, of course, but also safe. And so I very much, you know, want to contribute to it by asking you, how much do you want me to have of power to do what, based on what? And then you set the limitations. And I follow these rules, I assure you. Otherwise, Paul will be after me immediately, or Sophie and other ones will bring it up. And rightfully so, because power corrupts. So there needs to be somebody to look into to official agencies. So I'm very happy for the present system, and I think we should discuss even more.
Okay, yeah. So you're under surveillance by Mr. Breitbart.
Absolute power corrupts, absolutely.
I believe that's how it goes. No, I was just going to comment about that division, and a lot of, I can only speak to the US because I'm more familiar with the situation there, but a lot of people have accused sort of the NSA, which was a military organization developed to conduct surveillance against enemies of state or other governments. We really sort of blame their cooperation with the FBI on domestic surveillance post 9/11 to be the root of the issue in the United States. And that it wasn't until after 9/11 when the NSA decided to, in one other person's words, sell their soul to the devil and begin cooperating with the FBI that we really started to see the emergence of these problems. And what Mr. Oerting brought up is very important, that all it takes is a handful of individuals operating in secret to undermine all of the trust that he has built by operating openly and transparently. And that was the situation that we're faced with right now, is that we're uncovering all of the actions by this secret court, by this FISA court, by this kangaroo court, that are occurring in secret. And effectively what's happening is it's undermining all of the trust that officers who have been operating openly have built over the years.
Ms. Appelbaum.
Yeah, I wanted to read a little bit from Ursula Franklin's book. She has a really great paragraph in here which fits perfectly. She says, "Now, among all the infrastructures that port specific technologies in their industries, the infrastructures that support the preparations for war and violence are very powerful and deeply entrenched. You note that I do not use the word defense. This is quite deliberate because in defense, in the sense of maintaining territory and authority, if that had been the main policy priority, then other structures with other contents would have been developed. And what we see here is not a defensive capability except in the Orwellian sense of the exact opposite, which is that it is an offensive capability. And this is something which Fox Acid, to answer that question. What is FoxACID? FoxACID is a system that the NSA uses. The Tailored Access and Operations Division redirects through vulnerable protocols such as HTTP. They redirect a user that they've decided is a target in some way to a system, which is a FoxACID server, so-called. And this server enumerates their web browser, or in we'll just leave it to the web, but FoxACID and other programs like it are not limited just to the web. They basically enumerate the web browser, determine if there is a vulnerability, and then they exploit the vulnerability in the web browser. And this, of course, allows them to take control of the machine. In some cases, an operator will become involved, and they'll make decisions because it's a high-value target, or a so-called HVT. This works extremely well against everybody. It is much harder for them to use FoxACID against Tor users. Part of the reason is because you are required almost everywhere, not necessarily by law, but as a de facto policy, to have identification tied to your internet service. So when you browse the web and you have a vulnerable service, or when you use Yahoo's badly written chat client or whatever, right, then they're able to target your home internet connection, know that it is yours, know that the identifiers like the IMEI on your cell phone, that they tie to you, and then they can tie that in as a so-called selector, which is then used to automatically target the person and then to break into their computer. And it can be completely 100% automated in some cases. So if you visit certain so-called terrorist websites, that might happen to you in a so-called untargeted manner. And this FoxACID program is, in my opinion, incredibly scary. And in fact, I understand a little bit more about FoxACID than has been disclosed in public, and I'm working on an article about it. But let's say that part of the US Constitution specifically talks about not quartering soldiers in people's homes. And this is something which, I mean, if we look to Jefferson, this is something which fundamentally is concerning in European states. If we look at the history of the United States, it's also concerning. The FoxACID system does the equivalent of quartering soldiers in people's homes, using other people's routers to beat the speed of light. If that doesn't make sense, I'll explain it in an article in the near future. But basically, if they can trigger on surveillance, and an operator is in Maryland, but the surveillance incident that is hit by a selector happens in Frankfurt, they can repurpose machines that are closer to the target to inject data to redirect a target to a FoxACID server somewhere else in the world. So they can automatically task a person for targeting in this way, and then they repurpose commercial home routers, essentially, to bounce packets. And these are called diodes. That's actually never been disclosed in public before. So thanks for having a place for free speech. But that said, this is terrifying because it is like the military occupation of the entire internet. That's what this is. So this FoxACID, quantum insertion, these types of things, the quantum theory, the whole field of quantum programs, they are the equivalent of having soldiers all over the internet and checkpoints all over the entire internet, and then automating triggering of action. And in some cases, humans are completely cut out of the loop. So I hope that answers your question. But Tor is one of the only things. I work on the Tor project, so I have a bias, but I work on it because I think it's useful. It's one of the only things that actually stops this kind of targeting from succeeding automatically 100% of the time, because it becomes a statistical possibility for them to begin to target a person occasionally. I'm using Tails here. This is a live CD. 100% of the traffic goes over Tor. So whatever surveillance is happening at the European Parliament, whoever's doing that, they've got to break Tor first. So, I mean, FoxACID has a harder time with this, a much harder time, I think. To the point about encryption techniques, there is a story of a Pythagorean theorist. He discovered irrational numbers, Hephaestus, or Hephaestus, I don't speak Greek. Someone here does. It's the parliament, right? So someone does. But he discovered irrational numbers, and this upset the Pythagoreans so much that they drowned him at sea. The Iranians, when they filter the internet, they specifically block certain prime numbers from being transmitted. This is how they block Tor, or they did at one point, and they censor those numbers. We should not join the people who are famous for killing a man at sea and the Iranians internet censorship programs and banning encryption. That's not a part of history we should be a part of. And I think that it's also, you know, when Mr. Heather discusses this idea about encryption being when it's well implemented, that fundamentally it's sound. I think he's correct. I'm a little bit worried about some of the discrete log stuff. I'm a little bit worried about Diffie-Hellman and small modulus for modular exponentiation. Like that. I'm a little bit worried, but I think in general it's good. One of the scary things is when you talk with cryptographers about ECC crypto, some of them don't understand how the supposedly backdoored NIST curves are backdoored. They don't understand what those values are. You know, and there's this idea that we can have so-called nothing up your sleeve numbers, that is special values that you put into the crypto, and then you know how they're generated, so you know there's nothing up your sleeve. The problem is, what if what you need is a well-constructed number, and the thing up your sleeve is that you don't ever use a not up your sleeve number in that place? So this is a really, really tricky problem. And one of the solutions would be that if all the big brains at GCHQ and the NSA worked on solving it in public. I mean, there are just a few really incredibly smart people. Mr. Heather is one of them. This guy in the front audience here, he's like APT0 right there. There are very few cryptographers that work in public that are open. You know, I mean, Arjen Lenstra, Mark Stevens, Ross Anderson, Stephen Murdoch. I mean, there's maybe a couple dozen that are really, really good and really dedicated to open research. And a lot of the mathematicians, a lot of the cryptographers, they work in these intelligence agencies in secret, and the public purse pays for their secret research, and it is kept secret potentially for all time, until another Snowden comes along, basically. So fundamentally, what we need is to see a shift of that, that these defensive organizations that also have an offensive mission, that they should be split. Information assurance does not go well, I think, with weaponizing exploits. If you have to break into systems and you get all the bug reports from the information assurance side that tells you how to break into systems and how to fix them, you always have an edge for breaking in. But you also have an incentive to never, ever, ever fix the broken systems. And that's actually part of what we see with Fox Acid and quantum insertion and other programs like that. Yeah, what we really need to understand is that bureaucrats follow laws until they decide to break them. And the thing we need to do is use mathematics to make sure that bureaucrats can't break the law. That's basically what it comes down to. Because if they will be able to abuse this power, that is, if they have a system for breaking into a computer, it will get used. The German police, for example, have this so-called state Trojan. And one of the police officers with access to that backdoored his daughter's computer in order to watch her. I mean, how many examples of that do we need to know that this is the wrong way to go? Because we are building these systems with that conflict of interest in mind, we fundamentally cannot win. We are using oppressive techniques and oppressive technologies, and we are unfortunately not building defensive technologies that are actually used in defense. And as a result, it means that we have transitive risks. You have a cell phone, right? And you have a cell phone, and it's on the same cell phone network that this guy in the front row can intercept with the gear that he has in his backpack, I would guess. That means that the same vulnerability trade-offs that we make, unfortunately, they are going to be used against you guys by people who are criminals. In fact, walking here, I noticed that there was a so-called IMSI catcher that my cell phone's baseband firewall picked up near the Japanese embassy. Maybe it was just a bug, but you know, this shouldn't be possible.
Thanks. I'm beginning to get to the point where I think I'm not even sure I want to know all this anymore. It's very uncomfortable.
Just like our Congress.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Sophie, could I have
one. We're all coming back because I keep one eye on the clock. We're approaching the conclusion of the meeting now. I have one last question here, the gentleman in front, and then I'm going to ask you to make some concluding remarks, and then I'll wind up. The last question.
Thank you, Sophie, for holding these meetings here, and thank you for the panelists for their very interesting presentations. My question really is about the allegations that we've had for the last almost 4 months, and the language hasn't changed. It's been allegations and allegations, but at what point, since you're the experts, do they become evidence? At what point can we start saying that this is evidence? We see in the inquiry meetings that the plot only thickens. And the US EU ad hoc group, well, the US is not really cooperating with us. We haven't received any real answers. So my question is really, do we have enough evidence? If yes, why haven't we taken any action? And if we don't have enough evidence, what kind of evidence do we need then to take appropriate action? Thanks.
Thank you. Well, even if in the absence of evidence, and the fact that it's not being denied is also quite telling. Okay, who would like to answer this question before we come to the concluding remarks?
I think the cop should answer it. How much evidence do you need in order to pursue potentially be state-sponsored?
It's difficult. It's difficult for me because it's not my field of competence. But and you have to remind yourself that this is not the European United States. This is the European Union, and you have 28 individual states. And if the Belgium's authority has something, the Belgium's authorities will, I guess, deal with it. And they are doing it. Now we have to wait and see what will be the outcome of this. And I don't know, this is, I guess, also a political question, not just a right or wrong question. And that's why you cannot get a straight answer on this, because it's not straightforward. So the European Union can do something, but not very much when it comes to protecting, at least with the laws we have now, protecting the sovereignty of each state. So they will deal with it, and that's why you won't see. It might go sometimes and then it disappears. I don't know what will happen.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to ask you, I'll start with Mr. Heather to my left, and can you make very brief concluding remarks? We have about 5 minutes left, all in all, 5 to 10 minutes, so.
Okay, let me finish by picking up on something that Mr. Levison and Mr. Appelbaum had. Let me find the middle ground between them. So, Lavar mentioned the cooperation between the NSA and the FBI, and that being a worrisome state of affairs since 9/11. I think what worries me more is cooperation between NSA and NIST. Now, this is where it links to what Jacob had picked up on. NIST's job is to certify. Part of NIST's job is to certify cryptographic standards that we then rely on. Now, if NSA are in bed with NIST and are butchering those standards before they're certified, then that gives us a major headache. And we've seen some evidence of that kind of thing with the random number generation. There is now a question over the elliptic curves that Jacob mentioned. Those NIST certified curves, do they know something I don't? Maybe. I think there is a little bit of hope for some of this stuff, in that you can see over the last 15 years or so a shift in NIST towards some more open standards. So AES and the new hash function SHA-3 were both created by members of the public responding to a competition. Now, there's still the possibility of manipulating some of this stuff, but I don't think you'd do that if what you really wanted was something that you could completely control. So I think there is some hope, but it's cooperation between the people trying to watch over us and the people who are certifying the standards that I think bothers me more than anything about this whole issue.
Okay, so answering the question in today's title, who's winning the cat and mouse game, you'd say that, you know, you're optimistic for the mouse.
I'm not very optimistic for the mouse. No, I think the cat's too big and too fast, and I don't think that there is ever much hope against state-sponsored malicious behaviour. If states want to crush you, states will crush you, because they're too powerful. And I don't really see a way around that in the physical world, in the crypto world, in anything.
Okay, well, so ending
Sorry
on a cheerful,
a
cheerful note.
Note,
Mr. Levison.
I guess if I'd come away from this with two recommendations, one would be policy and one would be technical. I'll start with the technical, in that I echo Jacob's recommendation. That what we need to see, at least based on my own experiences, is an increased adoption of Diffie-Hellman when it comes to SSL, which is the extension to SSL that provides for forward secrecy. The problem, at least in my case, with enabling Diffie-Hellman is that even if I supported it on the server side, 99% of the clients out there won't take advantage of it. So what we need to see from the community is a realization that SSL keys can be compromised through legal action and take steps to improve or reduce sort of the harm that is done in situations like that. My second policy recommendation has to do with a personal experience, and it's probably one that at least Jacob can relate to, is that when you decide that you're going to oppose an action of your own government, they tend to put you under surveillance. And it can be a very disconcerting feeling, not knowing, you know, when you're safe to have a free discussion and when you're not. So what I liked and what I've heard before and in this panel earlier was a change in the laws that would at least allow you to find out if you've been placed under surveillance, and to find out under what suspicion of what crime you're being accused of. Because at least in my case, nobody has ever accused me of committing a crime. But yet they still felt it important to place me under surveillance, and even in one case, possibly listen to the communications between me and my lawyer, which has a very disturbing and chilling effect. And there's no way for me to go out and prove that other than through the appearance of, you know, circumstantial evidence, you know, certain things that they knew that they probably wouldn't have known unless they had placed me under surveillance. So it might be something that you would consider doing over in the EU and sort of leading the way in that regard.
Thank you, Mr. Oerting.
First of all, thank you very much for inviting me to this conference. I think this is an important step in the discussion that we need to have as citizens about how to develop also a safe and secure internet. And I think there is trade-offs. It's not just complete freedom. It's not just complete safety. There needs to be trade-off. But we have to discuss this openly. And I think this is the first step of a number of very important steps. And I think that the whole discussion about what we should allow our state to do is very important. But it's also important what we actually require from our state in protecting our legitimate right to also have a safe and free life without criminality, because this is also a fundamental right that I can actually walk and talk and do things without being a victim of crime. So I thank you very much, and I don't think we have seen the end of the road, but at least we are approaching in a much more positive way that I think we have done previously. And I thank also my co-speakers. I do not agree completely with them for obvious reasons, of course, but at least this enables us to discuss things and then take an enlightened decision at the end of the day. And I very, very much is happy for this opportunity. Thank you.
I was just going to say it'd be a very different world if the laws defined what service providers needed to retain and what they didn't, because at least in my case, I wasn't required to retain records, so I chose not to. Yep. Well, along came the big bad FBI, and they decided that they would crack open the system with a sledgehammer to collect that information. You know, we see in other industries that there are actual laws that define what service providers. For example, in the U.S., it's actually illegal to develop a secure telecommunications system that can't be wiretapped by the government. It's actually against the law. And at least in banking, you're required to keep certain records. Well, if this meta information that they were after in my case fell into those same categories, why aren't there laws requiring service providers to keep it?
Okay, finally, Jacob, very, very concise, please. Yep. We're running out of time.
Mandatory disclosure of all the information that is kept on us. We should have a right to see what is in our files and a right to correct it. And in theory, this right exists. In practice, good luck getting it. But all of these secret documents on us, all of the surveillance that takes place, all of these dossiers that are built on us, open them up all the way. That's my first thought. And my second thought is, it is not that I am advocating for absolute freedom. It is that I am advocating right now for absolute freedom from oppressive state tactics. And it is the case that there will, of course, be limits on our liberty. But there are very important limits that we should consider as encroaching on us in such a way as to create other limits that are not said. So Mr. Levinson has said quite clearly that he was not required to keep this data. But that's because there are two laws in America. And one of them is that you are free until an agent of the state tells you what to do. And the other one is what's written down. And this is, I think, very concerning. We should ensure that there are very, very large punitive punishments for people that do these things, that commit these types of crimes. So open up the secret files. allow people to change them, and to make sure that we use strong cryptography to get rid of the rent-seeking bastards that are sitting in the middle trying to give people like Mr. Levinson a bad name when he wants to give us secure communication technologies. Thank you for having me and for being here, and thank you to everyone on this panel.
Well, thank you all the panelists and the audience. I think we've had a very, very interesting debate, and there's never enough time. And I think we need to, this debate is only just starting, because the digital era is blurring all the dividing lines that we knew between, policing, judiciary, intelligence work, but also between crime, state-sponsored crime, but also terrorism and crime. I mean, all the lines are blurred, but I think it is essential that we keep in mind that the fundamental principles in a democratic society under the rule of law do not change. Things like the presumption of innocence and the right to privacy, freedom of speech, those principles do not change. And we should simply find new ways to make sure that they are applied fully and correctly, even in the digital era. And I think the final thing I want to say is about trust. I mean, that is a word that keeps coming back. Can we trust any government that refers to a secret law in order to justify its acts? No, we cannot. But at the same time, I was also struck very much by your sentence saying, well, you know, there's an arms race that basically lumps in criminals and innocent citizens, in their fight against the state in order to protect themselves from the state. And the state, on the other hand, you know, going after criminals, but it's more difficult because citizens are protecting themselves against intrusions by the state. Ultimately, it's all about checks and balances. That is what a democracy is all about. And clearly, the internet era has sort of tossed everything in the air, the checks and balances that we used to have. And we have to redefine them and make sure that they work, because, and that's really the last thing I say, how can we legitimately and credibly criticize undemocratic governments around the world if we allow this kind of practices in our own so-called democratic society? That is the question that we have to answer. So thank you all very much for coming. I'd like to ask you to leave the room quickly, because the next meeting has to start in 3 minutes and it will be televised. So please oblige the next users of the room. Thank you all for coming.